If this is the point at which I'm meant to preemptively apologize for leaving my subscribers for just under half a year without any new, exciting content, I'd caution that the images you're about to see will only deepen that void in your heart. It's actually pretty reasonable for any sane person to want to desperately tear out their eyeballs and denounce their humanity after bearing witness to the blood-curdling, bone-chilling horrors of Chuck Austin's US War Machine 2.0. Why am I subjecting myself to this unholy shit stain? Even more so, why am I subjecting you to this unholy shit stain? Well, with Jim Rhodes, commonly known by his alias War Machine, biting the dust in this year's Civil War 2, I think it's fitting that we go further down that symbolic rabbit hole and celebrate his colourful life with quite possibly the worst comic book of all time, or a strong contender for that title at the least. Now, Chuck Austin rose to infamy in the early 2000s with a spell of comics for Marvel that ranged from mediocre to laughably atrocious, with his work on Uncanny X-Men, notably his six-part The Draco storyline, being his magnum opus of bullshit. That said, Austin did do some work on War Machine in 2001 around 9/11 time, and then went on to write and draw US War Machine for Marvel's Max imprint after this. For anyone who doesn't know, Marvel's Max imprint was also launched in 2001 after Marvel completely severed its ties to the Comics Code Authority, a regulatory body established in 1954 after the publication of Seduction of the Innocent to ensure that comics were written in good taste and free of any graphic indecency. Stan Lee famously subverted the CCA once when he wrote a three-issue Amazing Spider-Man arc about Harry Osborn popping pills in the early 70s. Many great R-rated comics that were both canon to Earth 616 and out of canon came out of the Marvel Max line, including Alias by Brian Michael Bendis, one of his better works, which introduced Jessica Jones as a character, J. Michael Straczynski's Supreme Power reimagining of the Squadron Supreme, and Garth Ennis's Punisher Max. Though the Max line did produce its fair share of notorious turds, like X-Men Phoenix Legacy of Fire and the story we're about to read. I advise you all not to pay too much attention to the story. If you want a bare-bones idea of it, since a little context never hurt anyone, I suppose. Tony Stark and Jim Rhodes, this is out of canon I should probably add, have taken down the evil dictator Dr. Doom, and Stark has decided to lock away his War Machine battlesuits to prevent the government from abusing their power. SHIELD have created their own War Machine-like suits and convinced Jim Rhodes to don one and lead a team of operatives in suits too. And this angers Stark for obvious reasons. Seems compelling enough, but the real treat here is the art. See, the original US War Machine had fairly simple black and white art, you know, nothing special. But this uses poser models. Poser models are still used by some artists today to a degree, but I guess there was a certain novelty to releasing $3 comics filled with nothing but this style of raw, lifelike artwork, quote unquote. I should also mention that the artist for this book, a lad called Christian Moore, went on to never make any art for comics ever again after this. It's a shame, really, the world lost a great talent. In issue 1, we open to this page of Tony Stark doing something. I don't fucking know, guys. What circumstances led to this comic materializing into existence, nobody really knows. Don't worry, by the way, it only gets worse from here. This first page is followed by about 2 pages of more models, the variety of which is kind of impressive, I think. After being greeted by Tony Stark's laughing Xeroxed head, holy fuck, we find that this is all some weird fever dream being experienced by Tony as he inspects a bottle of Jack Daniels and sleeps with his head of security in classic Stark fashion. Behold, the visceral nature of their naked bodies, the physicality here is unmatched. Meanwhile, at SHIELD, cut to Tony Stark in his battle suit decapitating a life model decoy of Nick Fury and beating the snot out of Happy Hogan in a War Machine suit. This fistfight then turns into them talking about horses and shit as Tony yells some random crap about King Richard and brave knights for no apparent reason. According to Stark, King Richard's last words would be, "I'll piss in your dead eyes, Henry Tudor, and ride your corpse into hell." Seems like an unhealthy obsession with King Richard to me, but thanks for that insight anyway. Cut to the English countryside, and some bald fucker called Savelli, he prefers to be called Bob, gets a nasty surprise as some War Machine suits he tries to sell off to an old pal turn out to be SHIELD's team of Power Rangers looking War Machines. Prepare for no-holds-barred action as the War Machines blow these criminals to high hell, making the most of their hard R rating, as we see this burning Arabic dude writhing in sheer agony. These aren't your dad's superheroes. So much better than therapy. Dum Dum Dugan takes a second to admire this game of noughts and crosses etched in blood. There's detail in every single goddamn pixel of this comic, I tell you. This here blue war machine has a quick little fourth wall break as he sums up the entirety of the comic in a single page. It's all fun and games for about 5 seconds, everything else is suffering dialed up to 11. Issue 1, the first of this three-part series, ends with Jim Rhodes letting these bad dudes get away with a nuclear fucking bomb, in Nick Fury's words. Issue 2 begins with these beautiful faces taking up the bottom of the first page. Just think, trees have been cut down to print this stuff, living things were butchered just so Marvel could publish this sick joke. Great action shot of the shaled helicarrier here. Shit, it's Captain America, and all of S.H.I.E.L.D. are gathered to welcome him aboard. Now, obviously these models required some touching up to give a sense of dynamism and scale to them, so Christian Moore took the liberty of pasting in some enlarged JPEGs of his model soldiers to create a sense of foreground. Genie fucking us! Anyway, it's interesting to note that this comic is the first time Marvel ever used Bucky Barnes as Captain America, albeit in an Alterniverse story, as he would go on to take up the mantle from Steve Rogers after his death at the end of the First Civil War in mainstream continuity. Austin was a revolutionary in more ways than one. This dude must have been a fucking precog or something. In a nice slice of life panel, Nick Fury even imparts on us his musical tastes. He doesn't like N fucking Sync or Little Romeo. No, he enjoys the dulcet tones of Glenn Miller and the Andrews Sisters. Sue him, right? Making good use of the R rating, Rhodey stumbles upon this weird fucking Ralph dude using his Dark Hawk fantasy software to put a naked woman in a Scarlet Witch costume and have holographic sex with her. Rhodey's face says it all. This is pretty fucked up, not the kind of shit you would see in an Earth 616 comic. Once again, Austin predicted virtual reality hentai games long before Japan could even begin to contemplate that notion. Major Rhodey and Captain America then have a bit of a power struggle regarding their military rankings. Dum Dum Dugan tells Rhodey about his regular prostate checkups, something that we should all take the time to do. And we get a nice grandpa story from Dugan until Tony Stark shows up looking for trouble, showing off his metallic pelvic bulge. If you look carefully, the gold sections on his armor are translucent, really pushing the boundaries of normal artistic convention here, Mr. Moore. On this bombshell, we end issue 2. Issue 3 opens with an all-out turf war on the helicarrier. Tony Stark's war machines and S.H.I.E.L.D.'s war machines find themselves embroiled in vicious combat with one another. Stark and Rhodes finally come face to face in the ultimate test of war machine dominance, and I think we can all agree that putting some action figures in a fucking washing machine would make for a more coherent and dynamic action sequence than whatever the fuck all of this is. Like, what the fuck is this? Suddenly this nuclear weapon stuff comes into play again, as we learn that there's one in the middle of downtown London poised to kill millions of innocent men and women and children. Rhodey convinces Stark that hero stuff is more life and death than he was led to believe. Apparently pinching someone's head hard enough can make their brain squirt out, but Rhodey goes ahead and throws this laughing bad dude to his doom, which shocks Tony and justifies his desire to take back his suits of armor. I can't blame him, this is a little messed up, I suppose. Suddenly, Dr. Doom, that's right, he's behind all of this, what a tweeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeee by Hawkeye, who's in this comic too? Wow, and you probably thought Doom's treatment in the new Fantastic Four movie was shitty. This comic ends with Tony Stark bravely sacrificing himself to disarm Dr. Doom's nuke and getting fried up in the process. Rhodey gets the weird hologram fucking Ralph dude to put comatose Tony's brain in a dream world where he can be a hero forever. And on that bittersweet note, thus concludes US War Machine 2.0. What else can be said? 3D model porn probably has more artistic integrity than this entire limited series. It's so utterly horrible that I can't even begin to describe its problems. The story is pretty linear in of itself, The Dr. Doom reveal in his subsequent death is as rough as a dry scroll covered in solidified jizz, but whoever decided these issues were worth their $3 pricing should be shot in the foot multiple times and left to have their entire body ravaged by gangrene. If ever there was a reason why we've never seen another comic book illustrated using 3D models, all of you now know that reason. Giving US War Machine 2.0 a 1 out of 10 seems pretty damn generous to me, considering nothing in this comic works. Having exposed 3D model tits? That isn't hot in the slightest. No one's gonna fap to that. That's just messed up. If anyone does fap to that, I'd consider seeing a shrink, because that's pretty messed up, dude. So I say, we settle for a 0 out of 10, and have a nice day, my friends. Jesus fucking Christ. Alright, thank you for watching this video. If you like what you saw just now, you can head on over to my YouTube channel for some more exciting content that ranges from mediocre to laughably atrocious. Or, for your convenience, you can click on the links that I'm going to will into existence somewhere around here to watch a video which I'm going to put here, and one which I'm going to put here, and hopefully one I'm going to put here so you don't have to look at my ugly mug all the time, and it's going to be sick. Or you can head on over to my Facebook, I'm going to will a link to that into existence somewhere around here, and you can look at some behind the scenes images which I'm going to post there, just so you can get an idea of how I make these utter shit stains of videos. Alright, go kill yourself? Just kidding, don't actually do that. And before you go, what do you think of my new shades? Pretty fly, huh? Wait a minute. Oh.